Today we will discuss the response of single degree of freedom system subjected to impulse loading. So it's a new kind of dynamic loading. We have already covered harmonic loading, then periodic loading. So now impulse loading. So impulsive forces, for example, these shock loads, short duration loads, they may represent impact. Impact is a classical dynamic problem. Blast wave explosion, or for example, sudden stop or break of any vehicles or traveling cranes, for example. All of these real scenarios will produce a kind of dynamic loading, which can be categorized under this impulsive loading or impulse loading. So for example, a sudden shock wave of some blast will last for a fraction of a second. So this kind and that loading is actually dynamic, because it was once zero, it increased from zero to a particular value in a very short interval of time, and then again become zero. So it is a dynamic loading. In this lecture, we will be studying the response of single degree of freedom systems against these kind of impulse loadings. But this response, which we will be studying today, will also be useful for the analysis of response to arbitrary loadings, general dynamic loadings. So whatever we will study today, although it itself is a very useful thing, it itself will explain the response of any structure against impulse loadings. But the same concept will be used later also when we will shift to the response against general dynamic loading or arbitrary loadings. Arbitrary loading means that which is dynamic but which is not following any pattern, any you can say order. So the next lecture will be about the response against arbitrary loadings, and this information which we will see today, we will use that in the next class also, in the next topic also. So this is a step impulse. This is actually red line actually is representing a loading which is called step impulse, which means it is zero, no load. Within no time, it increased from zero to some value P naught, and then stayed there for a very short interval of time, which is delta T, and then from that, after that time, it again becomes zero, right? And then it stays zero for all the time. So this is called a step impulse, which means a kind of a rectangular loading, rectangular impulse loading. In order to categorize that loading as an impulse, this delta T should be very small. This delta T should be far less than the actual time period of the system, and then it will be categorized under impulse loading. This specific loading represented by red color is step loading, but there can be other kind of impulse loadings also. For example, if the loading is like this, that it linearly increase and then linearly decrease, but the time for that loading is very small, let's say delta T, and delta T is far less than the capital T, if capital T is representing the time period of the structure itself. So this is also an impulse loading, but it is not step impulse, it is like triangular impulse. Or impulse can have any shape. It can be like this also, for example, like this. It can be like half sine pulse, like increase sinusoidal and decrease and then remain zero. As long as the duration of that loading is very small, just a fraction of the total time period of the structure itself, it can be categorized under impulse loading, right? But in this lecture we will be only discussing step impulse, an impulse which remains constant for that very short fraction of a second. Constant means that this is a rectangular shaped loading, right? So in this lecture our target is to calculate the response u of t against this kind of p of t, right? So we, for the sake of simplification in calculations, we divide the response into two phases. One is called phase 1, which is loading phase. It is a very small phase in which there is actually some loading. And after this phase, after the time delta t, loading becomes 0, which means that after this delta t time, the structure will be vibrating freely because loading will become 0, and then structure will oscillate with free vibration. So phase 2 is actually free vibration phase. It starts from where the loading end and then it continues until the oscillation decays to a very negligible value, right? So we have two phases of response. Loading phase, the response in the time when there was loading, and then free vibration phase, phase 2. So this yellow line is actually the response. This yellow or orange line is our response, and this is our u of t. This is we want to calculate actually. We want to calculate this response. The governing equation of motion will be same, mu dot dot function of time plus cu dot function of time plus ku function of time is equal to p of t. Now p of t is representing this red kind of this impulse loading, rectangular impulse like this, right? So impulse is defined by just this magnitude p naught, and then duration delta t, and from where it starts at t equal to 0, and delta t over capital T is far far less than 1. This is the definition of impulse. So our rectangular impulse or step impulse will be described by these two quantities: what is delta t and what is p naught. Only these two quantities are required to actually plot that impulse loading. Let's assume for this specific solution that the structure was at rest and there was no initial velocity. So we are assuming 0, 0 initial conditions when the impulse was applied, right? So let's first check phase 1. Phase 1 is the loading phase, this one. It is the part of response in which there was applied loading, right? So in this phase, if you look at the response of this equation, mu dot dot plus cu dot plus ku is equal to p of t. Now this again is a non-homogeneous second order differential equation, and we have some non-zero p of t, and we know already that the solution of this equation comprise of two parts. One is called homogeneous part, the other is called particular part or particular solution. The particular solution actually depends on what kind of function is on the right hand side. We have seen in the harmonic case that if we have sinusoidal function on the right hand side, the up will also be sinusoidal. If p of t is a constant number, then up will also be a constant number. And in phase 1, which is the loading phase, if you just look at this phase only, you see that loading is constant. Loading is constant p naught. So if you talk only about phase 1, then your p of t is constant. Resultingly, your up of t will also be constant, and you know that if applied loading is constant, then the response is simply P naught over K. Applied loading is constant means applied loading is static. When the applied loading is static, no inertial action, no damping action, right? So the U will simply be P naught over K if P of T is constant for phase 1. So this is our phase 1 situation, that we are in between time 0 and time delta T. We are in this range, and in this range P is constant, which is equal to P naught. Obviously, if we have a different kind of impulse loading, if we have a, for example, triangular impulse, which is like this, or for example, half sine pulse, which is like this, obviously this UP of T will be different. But currently we are considering only rectangular impulse, so our P of T remains constant in the phase 1. And resultingly, we can say that UP of T is simply P naught over K. So we can see that this equation satisfies our equation of motion, because if we take UP of T P naught over K, we take first derivative, it will be 0. First derivative of constant is 0, and second derivative is also 0. And when we put that, we will see that it is satisfying that equation. This will be P naught over K, and then K will be cancelled. This is 0, 0. So it is satisfying that equation. So this UP of T is P naught over K. That is our phase 1 response. So it is satisfying the governing equation of motion in phase 1. In phase 1, our equation has P naught on the right hand side, a constant force. So the general solution in phase 1 will be UP of T plus UH, and UP of T is already P naught over K, and UH we know already that it is e raised to power minus xi omega T into some A cos omega dt plus B sin omega dt, or A sin plus B cos. A and B are arbitrary constants which depend on initial conditions. If we are given with some initial conditions, we can force this equation to satisfy those initial conditions and calculate A and B, right? So let's solve this equation for the case when there are zero initial conditions. U of 0 is 0, and U dot of 0 is also 0. If we are given these initial conditions, we can calculate A and B. We can force this equation to then we can calculate specific values of A and B as a function of initial conditions. So if I put 0, 0 initial conditions in this particular solution, I will get, obviously I should put T equal to 0 on both sides. This will be 0. This cos 0 will be 1. Similarly here, e raised to power this thing will be 1. And I will have 0 here, right? And again, for the second initial condition, I have to take first derivative of this equation 2 and put T equal to 0 again, right? So if I do these two things, I will get these two equations which can be simultaneously solved to get A and B. So the first initial condition give me this equation, second give me this equation. I rearrange them, solve them, because this is 0 and this is also 0. I can just simply derive what B is and what A is. So now I can exactly know what A and B is for 0, 0 initial conditions. I can put these A and B back in the same original equation, this one, equation 2, and my solution will be complete, right? But this will be the equation which is representing the solution only in phase 1, for that very fraction of a second when there was some loading. So in that fraction of a second, whatever the response is, that is governed by this equation which we have derived up till now. So actually we are in phase 1. So this small portion of response, this one, which I am just highlighting by red color, this small portion of response is actually the response of phase 1. So whatever equation we have derived is actually valid for this small portion. It is the equation of this small line, right? And phase 2 we will see after that. So let's complete that solution. Let's put A and B back in the expression. In this equation 2 we can put A and B and then complete that solution. So this equation 4 is our complete solution. We have already put A and B, right? This is A and B coefficients, we already put that. So this is B, this is A. So we can further simplify that. One observation here is that in this term A, xi is coming without any, you can say it is just coming directly and it has a very low value. So one assumption we can further assume that this whole term we can just ignore it, because this will be like 0.05 or even less than that. So it is being multiplied by everything. So one simplification for lightly damped systems, we can assume that this whole thing is just negligible. And again I repeat that this equation is valid for only this range 0 and delta t, where delta t is very small, fraction of a second. So what we can do is that we can just ignore this thing, this whole thing, and then we can rearrange this equation. Obviously when we, for example, kind of put xi equal to 0, this whole thing will vanish. So approximately we can just rearrange the equation 4 in this form. U of t is approximately equal to p naught over k, will be here also and here also, so we can take that common, and it will be simply p naught over k 1 minus cos omega t, right? So it's like kind of we ignore damping to get a very simple form of that equation. So it is the, again I repeat, this is the equation governing the very starting part of that response, right? It is the part of response which is when there was impulse. So this is showing the response during the loading phase. So this is phase 1 response. Now go to phase 2. Phase 2 starts when the loading becomes 0, right? So the phase 2 starts from this time when t is equal to delta t, and when loading is 0, which means that phase 2 is simply free vibration response. But the initial conditions for that free vibration is already provided by phase 1. So whatever is the response at the end of phase 1 is the initial displacement for phase 2, and whatever is the velocity at the end of phase 1 is the initial velocity for phase 2. So we can use the same free vibration equation with these two initial conditions, whatever are the values at the end of phase 1, and we can use the same equation and we can plot the phase 2 response. So let's work out what are the initial conditions at t equal to delta t, because at t equal to delta t we have the initial conditions for phase 2. So we already have the equation u of t, a very simple equation, approximate equation, because we ignored damping in that. So in that equation, let's put t equal to delta t, and that will become the initial displacement for phase 2 when we put t equal to delta t, right? So we replace t equal to delta t in the equation we derive for phase 1. So t is replaced by delta t, here also t is replaced by delta t. So now this is my initial displacement for phase 2. Similarly, I can take the first derivative of this response in phase 1 and replace t with delta t again, and this will become my initial velocity for phase 2. So now we have kind of u of 0 and u dot of 0 already, and we can use the same equation, replace this u of 0 and u dot of 0, and we are done with phase 2 also, right? So now let's further simplify, use Taylor expansion here for cos and sin. We know that for very small values of theta, Taylor expansion tells us that sin theta can be approximated by that angle itself, theta, right? And cos theta for very small values of theta is almost equal to 1. So we neglect higher order terms in Taylor expansion of sin and cos, because theta itself is very small. So theta cube, theta 5 will be very small also. So we can use this further simplification in our initial conditions equation. Why? Because we know already that delta t is very small time, fraction of a second, and it is in that angle of sine and then in angle of cos. So which means that this cos theta have a theta which is very small. So we can approximately say that this whole quantity will be almost 1, and this whole quantity will almost be equal to theta. So it is omega into delta t, and this is 1. So when we put this thing 1 minus 1 will 0, which means we will say that approximately the displacement at the end of phase 1 is almost 0. So that small value of displacement, this one, we are kind of ignoring. So it's like initial displacement for phase 2 is 0, almost 0. Whatever value, very small value it have, we just ignored it when we approximate cos omega delta t by 1, right? So it's like saying that the phase 1 is actually causing almost no displacement. So this small displacement, because this is u of t, so this small displacement, this value at the end of phase 1 is almost 0, negligible. But this will not be the case with the initial velocity for phase 2. If you just put sin theta equal to theta, you will get p naught over k into omega square delta t, right? This will be your initial velocity for phase 2. So let's work that out. So u of delta t will be almost 0. So initial displacement for phase 2 is 0. And the initial velocity u dot of delta t is when you apply sin theta equal to theta, approximately, you get p naught omega square delta t over k, right? So everyone is clear up till this point? Any doubt? Clear? This can be again rearranged as p naught delta t over m, because this omega is under root k over m. And we can write m as omega square over k. K over omega square. So omega square over k is 1 over m. So this is the same thing. Now this p into delta t is sometimes called impulse. It is a physical quantity called impulse. It is the maximum value of impulsive loading times the duration for which it is applied, right? So impulse divided by mass is the initial velocity, and we can also rearrange or reinterpret that equation, because p naught delta t over m is equal to u dot of delta t. So this is velocity, and mass times velocity is momentum. So we can say we can rearrange that equation to say that impulse is actually the change in momentum of that mass, right? Mass times velocity is momentum. So if you look at the situation here, what is happening? That phase 1 has not caused a significant displacement, it has just imparted an initial velocity to phase 2. So impulse is like an initial velocity. Impulse loading is like an initial velocity which is imparted to the system itself. So the role of phase one is actually not to give the initial displacement, but to give initial velocity, right? So when the impulse loading hit your structure, it is as though your structure is applied with some initial velocity. This have been demonstrated mathematically here, that while u of delta t is approximately equal to 0, u dot of delta t is not 0, is not close to 0. It has a very specific value which depends on three quantities. One is the amplitude of that impulse loading, one is the duration of that impulse loading, and then third quantity is the mass of your structure, right? So if your structure is massive, you may experience less initial velocity as a result of a particular impulse, right? But if your impulse have a high amplitude, or it remains for a longer duration, relatively longer duration, then it may impart a very high initial velocity, right? So I repeat again that phase one is causing almost negligible initial displacement to phase two. At the same time, it is causing some initial velocity to phase two, and that initial velocity is this. So which means that if we use now the same free vibration expression with these two changes, that u of 0 is 0 and u dot of 0 is this thing, we will get the phase 2 response, right? So again, one way to interpret this situation is this one, that impulse introduces momentum into the structure, but the duration of impulse is so small that the displacement has not developed yet. The structure just started its displacement, and the loading was already zero. Loading was already gone, right? So just think of, for example, in cricket, for example, if you hit that ball, a very high velocity ball, if it is approaching you and you are hitting it with bat, that fraction of a second, in that fraction of a second, the displacement of ball will be negligible when there is contact between bat and ball. But that situation will actually impart a very high initial velocity to your ball, right? So the almost the whole response of your structure will be free vibration response. The almost the complete response is free vibration. That small part of response in the phase one is negligible if you talk about displacement only, right? So let's now use the same free vibration equation with these two changes. U of 0 is 0, u dot of 0 is what? P naught m, P naught delta t over m, this one. And one more change, because that free vibration equation which we have derived, that was actually what? E raised to power minus xi omega t into some u of 0. Now we will not be using a and b, because we actually know that this u of 0 and u dot of 0 are available now. So we will be using u of 0 cos omega, I think, plus something you can remember, some sine thing, sine omega t. So one change will be u of 0 will be 0, the next change will be u dot of 0 will be p naught delta t over m, and one more change, t will be replaced by t minus delta t, because that equation is actually meant to start from t equal to 0. But our phase 2 is starting from time t equal to delta t. So therefore, our equation should not start from t equal to 0. It should start from t when t was equal to delta t. So therefore, delta t will be subtracted from all times in the original equation. So t will be replaced by t minus delta t. So it's like our phase 2 is a free vibration response which is starting from some delta t time, So it is starting from this, you know, delta t time. So t will be replaced by t minus delta t, and since u of 0 is almost 0, so cos term will be vanished and only sine term will remain when you put u dot of delta t, the actual value p naught delta t over m, and similarly t minus delta t will be replaced, t will be replaced by t minus delta t. You will get equation 9. Actually, when you put the initial velocity also, you will get this equation. And one more simplification, that t minus delta t can be simply replaced with t. Ideally, it should not be replaced, but we can ignore that very small duration in the start. And for the simplicity, we can simply say that this equation is the governing equation of response, and it is starting from t almost equal to 0. Right, so we can assume that this response have started right from the time when there was a contact or when there was some start of impulse loading. So this is our final equation, and it is a sinusoidal motion because sine is there, is multiplied by a constant quantity, and decay function is also being multiplied. So it's like a sinusoidal motion which is reducing its amplitude with each cycle, and the amplitude is this one, right? Amplitude is p naught delta t over m omega d. So it is intuitive also. You can think of any structure which is subject to impulse loading, and you will see that it will just start its free vibration with some initial velocity depending on the properties of the impulse loading itself, p naught delta t, and the mass of the structure itself, right? So we have actually worked out the response of that that orange line or response equation, this equation. Now we will be using the same equation for response against arbitrary loadings also. I assume that you will try the solution for other kinds of impulse loading also, or at least check in different books. For example, half sine pulse, for example, a triangular pulse, right? So there are empirical expressions available which can convert your real loading scenarios into the shape of your impulse loading. If there is a vehicle collision or an explosion, or some other, for example, shock wave from some blast, all of those real loading scenarios for impulse loading, they can be converted into some idealized shapes of impulse loading. Step impulse, which we have just considered now, is one of them, right? But there are other kinds of impulse loadings also. So in different reference books, you will even find the comparison of responses for different shapes of impulse loadings, right? If, for example, the same p naught is applied in a triangular impulse shape or a half sinusoidal, half sine pulse kind of wave, or any other kind of pulse. There will be some difference. So you please check those comparisons. Sometimes, for example, one of our thesis students was working on an airplane crash into a building case, impact case. So he was able to report that the actual impulse shape will be something like this. This is when there is a first part in contact, and then the second peak will be when the then main engine will hit the structure itself. So shape will matter, obviously. It different shapes may produce different initial velocities, right? And then you can use the principle of superposition For example, you know the response against one impulse, and if there is another impulse after some time, you can use the same equation to get the response against that impulse separately, and then sum stitch all the responses. This is something which we will be using actually in the arbitrary loading chapter, this superposition of different impulses. That's why I use the word stitch. Stitch means that you will have the same time scale. For example, your question was about this case, that you have one impulse, then zero, and then another impulse, right? So the response for first case will be what? Like this. The response for second case will be what? Zero, and then like this. You just stitch them, just sum for each time instant, one by one, and you get something like this. Right, like this, right? So when the response for second impulse start, they will add up. So it's like assuming that for that particular fraction of a second when there is applied loading, there is no effect of damping. So that assumption is reasonable, because in that particular fraction of a second, you may not have any effect from damping. So for phase one, we ignore damping and we assume that xi is far less than one, so let's ignore everything. Because we ultimately are interested in response in phase two. Phase one is something which is simply providing initial conditions for phase two. The structure will get peak amplitude in phase two, right? So it's like structure was sleeping and phase one is actually woke him up, right? So the response actually started from phase two. Whatever we are doing in this class up till now, they are classical solution. Classical solution mean that just like you solve any second order differential equation, we are solving it and we are deriving exact solutions, right? Mathematical solutions, closed form expressions. We will be actually studying one method for general dynamic loading or arbitrary loading, the topic which I am about to start now. In that, we will study one method. All the commercial mainstream programs, they use that method to solve for any dynamic loading, because that once you know a numerical method, an approximate method to handle any arbitrary loading, you can apply the same method to even harmonic loading or periodic loading or impulse loading, because general dynamic loading, that theory will be applicable to all the other cases. So if you remember, in the start of this course I told you that there are different solution methods for structures. One is classical solution method, but that is only limited to few simple kind of dynamic loading. So for harmonic, classical solution was possible, we have actually seen it. For periodic, it is possible because of that Fourier series concept. For impulse, it is possible because we can define that impulse mathematically by an equation. But when we go to general dynamic loading, which is arbitrary, no order, no pattern, we cannot define that loading with some polynomial or some sine function or some mathematical function. For that, we have to go to numerical methods, approximate methods. In that, we will use some assumptions. And in that case, the beautiful conceptual elegant classical solution will not be possible, as we are seeing here, right? In that case, we have to go for approximate method, and all the commercial programs use those methods, and that is not one method actually, there is a family of those methods. We will be just understanding or discussing one of those methods. So there are maybe 10-15 methods, and they keep on coming more and more with new advancements. So there was a time when we used to develop a method first mathematically and code in computers. Nowadays, we directly develop methods for coding. Methods are developed nowadays with an intention that no one will actually use them for manual calculations. They are developed for programs nowadays, right? So those methods are numerical methods. One of them we will study, that is an easy one, we will study for single degree of freedom case. So your question is about a loading which looks like this, that it is zero and then suddenly it goes to P naught and then stays there. So it will still be an impulse loading, and there many of the impulse loadings are actually like this. They are actually like this. If, for example, if there is a sudden you can say change in anything, any component of a structure, it may impart this kind of loading. So the response will actually be a free vibration case first, but it will not come back to zero. It will converge to some value which will be P naught over K, right? So it's like a fluctuating response. The structure will actually oscillate, but it will rest at some new location because the load is now sustained. This scenario is similar to when, for example, one column is completely damaged in a building due to a sudden collision or some blast, for example. What will happen to the remaining structure? It will simply experience an additional loading which was initially handled by that column, right? Now suddenly that column is no more, so the structure will experience an impulse, but then it will rest to some permanent deformation, right? So this will be the case when structure is elastic, by the way, when the structure is linear, right? Yeah, in nature maybe they can be considered dynamic, but generally by dynamic loading we mean a loading which is changing its amplitude in a matter of seconds, not in a matter of hours or days. So for example, someone may say that even the loading of these chairs is dynamic. One may argue because at least their location is changing, their mass is also changing if we add more chairs, for example. But generally by dynamic loading we mean a loading which is changing its amplitude in a matter of few seconds or few minutes, like earthquake loading or wind loading or impulse loading, for example, right? So let's conclude this discussion about impulse loading, and now let's use the same expression and extend the discussion about the response of general dynamic loadings.